March edition of Strapped In. I'm your host, Mike Feltenberger. And tonight we have two members on the guest panel tonight. We have Grandview sportsman racer Kenny Bock, and we have his father, a former, what was that, a hill climb and dune buggy and racer and
drag racer,
Greg Bock. So if you have any questions for any of the panel, home viewer line is 610-378-0426. Results. The Short Track Super Series up at Port Royal Speedway. The modified division was won by Anthony Perego. Williams Grove Opener was won by Lucas Wolf in the 410 Sprint Cars. Upcoming events, open practices Friday night, Linda Speedway for all classes. Saturday, March 30th will be the Grandview free to the public practice session for any class of car that wants to show up Saturday down at Grandview. Right now, the predicted temperature is supposed to be 72 degrees and nice and sunny, so it's free to the public. Come on down and watch your racers get prepared for the 2019 season. Also, Shellhammer Speedway, up right off of Route 61, right past Leesport. They will be having their practice session from noon to 5. Shellhammers took their old guardrails down. They put the three-rail guardrails up there. So it looks like some fantastic racing going to be up at the Oval up in Leesport. Upcoming events is the Grandview Opener next Saturday night, April 6th. It'll be the Bruce Rogers Moneymaker. It is an open class race for small blocks or big blocks. If you want to run either, you'll still be running for that. It's $7,500 to win. And the sportsman, are you running for points that night?
I don't know if it's points.
Just the money race. Yeah.
I think it's $750 to win the sports.
Yeah,
so the sports will be running for some added money as well next Saturday night down at Grandview. Williams Grove is going to try to get their first night race in Friday night, April 5th, with 410 sprint cars and late models. Home viewer line, 610-378-0426. Kenny, with all the sports or activities to choose from, what spurred your interest into auto racing?
Well, I guess it was kind of happenstance. I grew up playing baseball, and I wrestled for quite a number of years. And we always went to Grandview and all the local tracks just to watch racing. And he raced back in the day, and I think he got sick a couple years back, and we just decided we can't take our money with us. So bring the family together, and here we are racing a sports in a Grandview.
What spurred you on to do the drag racing and the hill climbs and everything else that you did then, Greg?
When I grew up, my dad had nothing to do with racing, and that's probably why.
No,
just because every car I ever had that was his, I raced, and then he retired, and I built a car, a drag car, and got him to the races one time. He was like a kid.
Now, when you were younger, did you go to auto racing even though your father didn't like racing?
Oh, yeah. He didn't go.
But you went.
Oh, yeah.
Found a way to go with somebody?
Oh, yeah. My buddies, you know. My brother.
Okay. Kenny, if you're planning on attending the Grandview practice, is this to get a feel for the car or to make future notes or just to see if everything is in working order?
I think a little bit of all three. I think this year for practice, we're definitely looking to do a couple drastic setups just to see how the car, what those setups will do and see how the car, how that changes, how the car handles. I think this year we're doing a lot better job of recording all of our, statistics and all the data, I suppose, for all the setups and different track conditions and stuff. So I think this year it'll be a little more learning and I think a lot more work.
Okay. Prior to the show, we had a little bit of chit-chats going on out in the lobby area, and it came down that your mom's the Chad Knaus of your racing team.
So the one really, well, she helps with the setup every week with writing all the stuff down and reading the book and how to move weight around in the car. And our best finish, she did the setup. She told us what to do. We didn't have any input. We just said, okay, turned the wrenches and came up with a third. So can't complain.
Greg, when you ran drag racing, was it actual drag racing or was it who had the fastest time at the time then? Was it?
I bracket raced.
Okay.
But, fairly fast car. You know, it was just strictly drag racing, you know. Hold it to the track, haul it on, you know.
Okay. We got a home viewer. Thank you for calling. How can we direct your question?
I have a question for Kenny. Kenny,
did you give up baseball and take up racing when Ryan Topper took you deep? Or
I played a year of college ball after he took me deep. No, I'm still playing baseball. Is Ryan Topper still playing baseball?
I think so.
Maybe we'll play against each other this year.
So you're a pitcher?
I'm a catcher.
Catcher?
Yeah.
Well, then how could he take you deep if you're the catcher?
Well, I was back in high school. We weren't good buddies in high school, but turned out to be good buddies after high school. And he hit a real, real bad, ugly home run off me. Kind of tip your cap and move on.
Now, you said your mom takes notes. Now, do you get a feel for the car during hot laps, or is this one of them things you'll try to work on something after qualifying?
Yeah, a little bit of both.
Because the track sort of changes from the time you go out for hot laps to the time.
So we go with a setup for the hot lap, the warm-ups. A lot of stagger because it's a real heavy track. So we try to run as much stagger as we can. And then as the track dries out, we try to make little adjustments depending on if the sprint cars are running that night or whoever is running that night. We try to adjust per night. And it's a lot of help. We were talking before about this. It's a lot of help being so close to the track where we pit. It's like the first year we had to run almost a quarter mile round trip to go see, like, just to see if the tracks were changing. Yeah. And now we can just stand up on the top of the truck and kind of peek over.
Now, do you have one of those complete setups, scale setups in the shop that you can weigh each corner of the car?
Yeah, we bought a set of used scales the first year. I got them refurbished the past 2 years. So we have a car and a half garage that we keep the car at, and little scale cart that we bring out from the basement and weigh it each. I guess it's a Thursday, sometimes a Friday. Us three. Sometimes it's them two. Sometimes it's us two. It depends on how our schedules work out.
You ever take the car out, Greg?
They won't let me. I want to, though. And I know Brad was talking about having a owner's race this year, so never know.
Yeah. Did you ever, do you sit in it for anything, or?
Oh, yeah. You don't want to take a picture of me.
Randy.
Kenny, when you first started, was it what you expected, or did you sit there and think, holy crap, what am I getting into? I mean, what was it like your first couple races you went out there?
The holy crap. I honestly, you know, I was one of those guys in the stands like, oh, I can do this, I can do that. And I was like, you know, you get those guys that do that. And I finally got the opportunity to, and I found a new respect for what these guys and now what myself, what we do. Mm-hmm. It's a lot more than what people do. You don't just go out there and race in a circle. It takes a lot more. Not just physically, but just with like just the setup and just trying to figure out how to just be successful night in and night out.
Especially like your first feature where you had like 23 cars around you.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden maybe you're in the middle of the pack or something. It's like, what do I do now? I got all these guys buzzing around me.
It's daunting just to have those guys of such a good class of racing just flying by. Like at the first race I had a 10-pound load in my pants. I was very scared.
Okay, with that answer, I'm going to move this question all the way up. After spending your hard-earned money and time in the garage and having a subpar night on the speedway, do you feel race fans are too harsh and demoralizing on social media after a rough night?
Not for our class, maybe a couple guys, but not for like my level of racing. But I feel as though once you get to the higher levels, higher big block modifieds and sprint cars, yeah, I feel like there is a little bit of scrutiny with how the fans treat the race car drivers, but that goes in every sport, so it's just kind of the territory.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Greg, and what you ran, the hill climbs and every or whatever, and the drag racing, was there any rules as far as engines or chassis or shocks? Was there any kind of rules in what you ran?
No.
Really? Everything was open?
Pretty much.
So whatever
because you... Because the bracket racing, you could just... I mean, just safety stuff, but other than that, there was no rules. I mean, when I ran Linda's, there was a cubic inch rule and stuff, but there wasn't a whole lot of rules back then. That was 91 now, when I ran up there.
That was dune buggy racing, right?
Yeah.
Did they have the hills and...
No. This was just on
the... On the quarter mile.
Yeah, on the oval.
Wow.
Yeah, it was fun. I told him, I don't care what you're racing, if he's racing a sportsman or I was racing a dune buggy, you're in the middle of the pack, it's all the same.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Yeah. In the middle of the pack, it's all the same, no matter what you're racing.
Oh, okay. Okay, here we go. This is the popular Facebook question. With all the rainouts last year, Kenny, do you feel that hindered your progress into making the top 10 in points? I know you had a long time to think about this.
Yeah, no, it wasn't long enough. Well, that's tough because the last couple races, we had a couple good guys have motor problems or just stupid stuff happen. So I don't want to say I would or I wouldn't, but I have strong feelings that we might have been in the top 10 if we would have had one or two more races. I know, Kurt, if you're watching, you don't like that answer.
Now, there's times where guys where they're running for points, they'll say they'll run for the position instead of the win. Did you sort of have that theory going into the season, or did you want to try to be up front as much as possible?
I think everyone wants to be up front as much as possible, but there were times where, like in a heat race, where I could have stuck my nose in under somebody and maybe pushed, like had a little hairy situation. Those were times where I think last year I was a little complacent and I just got to pick my times this year. But yeah, I feel like I did race a little conservatively, especially in those heat races. Once I got into a qualifying position, if you're fighting for a spot and get kicked to the back, it's a tough road with two laps to go. Mm-hmm. So
actually, what it comes down to, you want to qualify, but you actually want to be in a handicap spot. So instead of having to start, 15th on back, you can start first through 14th, and I guess that would make it a little bit easier on you. But do you sort of keep track of that as the race is going on? If, say you're starting fourth, and if I stay here without anybody passing me, I'm locked into the handicap. Is that something you sort of keep in your head?
Yeah, I think for me personally, it only happens when I'm like pre green flag, where the yellow's out and you're kind of trying to count, especially in the feature where you're kind of counting cars and you're seeing where you are and where like you need to be. But once the green flag drops, it's all racing. We're just out there trying to gain ground. Trying to be faster.
Home viewer line 610-378-0426. Greg, where'd you drag race?
Oh, I drag raced in Maple Grove till Mike Lewis left there, and then that place changed. So I went down to Cecil County and Atco, Englishtown, which is no more.
What kind of car did you run?
Camaro, 67.
Oh, okay, because when I was a young lad, my mom bought me a car for my graduation. She didn't know what she was actually getting, and she got me a 66 Ford Galaxy with the 289 high rise.
Nice.
And I knew what I had once I hit the gas, and there I am, 17 years old in this hot rod. But I left my friend take it to Maple Grove, and we had the second fastest time.
She's
not
adopting, is she?
But that was just one of them deals. I let my buddy run the car, and we had second fast time for like 5 or 6 years with it. So it was a gas hog. But back then, gas was only 18 cents a gallon.
Yeah,
it's how fast usually they all are.
Randy.
This winter, talking to guys by telephone or going to shops or whatever, after Hurthler and Whitmoyer basically dominated the 38er, a lot of people are grumbly, whatever you want to call it, about they're going to let the 604s, the 602s, and the sportsmen, all open sportsman cars, all run together in one group. Is there any problem with that this year, do you think, with the sportsmen? What's your opinion on the three of them coming together as one group?
Well, I have an open sportsman, so obviously I'm running out of places to race. But I think it's good, because I remember hearing, I want to say the split like between crates and opens. There was a pretty good split on feature wins this year at Grandview. I don't think a guy won three times. I don't think there was a three-time winner.
Okay.
So the wealth is pretty evenly split. I have no issues with it, but I'm sure the guys that run crates are grumbling about other crap.
Well, because like the 602 crates kind of feel like they're left in the dust, more or less, because they're the lowest on the food chain.
Right, I guess. Yeah. Well, yeah, on the dry track, they definitely have the advantage, but I don't know. We'll have to see how this year plays out.
But then again, it depends now with if we run two divisions, will you run on a wetter track or a dry track or
that's
exactly when the features are going to run.
Exactly, you know? I honestly think it should, be one class and just done. Done deal.
Oh.
I don't know, but that's, then you have the problem with like, then 602s run 1 week, then opens run 1 week, and it's like, then we don't get to race as much.
Yeah.
Do you think it's eventually going to become a crate class with the sportsmen? You think that's eventually where they're headed?
Yeah, I think all track. It's more standardized. It's easier to, it might not be easier to tech, but it sounds easier to tech crate motor. It sounds like it should be pretty cut and dry, but you know how that goes.
Okay, you have the Grandview season on your schedules. After Grandview's done for the year, do you go off and roam around and find places you've never been to before and see what happens?
Well, we try to find places we have been to before, so we get a little familiarity with some foreign tracks. But, we try to travel around. We make sure we hit Susquehanna once a year, and we hit, the first year we went to I-88, that changed to Afton, and then Five Mile Point. And then, like I said, they're all going to crates, so... Yeah. And we just keep running out of places to race, unless like Brett Deo does the Open versus Crate Sportsman.
Mm-hmm.
So those are great races for us. I love racing those races.
Well, the 5 mile would go to crates. Could you still take your Sportsman at the end of the year and run with them?
I think it would have to be a special race where it was Open versus.
Oh, okay.
Crates.
So if it was like their regular show,
you
couldn't run your Sportsman.
No, yeah,
like the American Racer Cup.
Yeah, right.
You can run in that. We can run in that, but.
It's only one open.
So the big show at the end of the year that Brett runs, the very last, the big point show.
The working man's race.
You can run that one.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
Okay. With that, with going to some of these tracks, do they all have sail panels or is it an open body for that? Or must you take your sail panels off and put regular panels on? What happens at the end of the year?
So we'll take the sail panels that we run at Grandview off for all the New York tracks. And then once we get back down into Susquehanna for the Halloween time.
You had the cow last year.
Yeah, I did. Bessie. No. But we'll put the sail panels back on for Susquehanna and then the end of the year race at Grandview. And I personally like the window panels. I think they look a little sleeker. But
Who's in charge of the car cleaning after a Saturday night?
Usually it's me and my dad and my girlfriend, Helen. We'll be out before baseball game. I play baseball on Sunday, so we'll be washing the car in the front yard at like 9 in the morning. I'm sure waking the neighbors up with the pressure washer.
I was just going to say, I bet the neighbors love that.
Yeah.
Now, you're from down around the Birdsboro area.
Yeah.
They had some popular race teams and some great people come from out. Do you get anything from any of the former racers or the pit crew members or the owners or anything down there to see what you're doing, or
we like to go to the Birdsboro Napa and see John Schutte and his dad, and we're pretty friendly with him. But other than that, I don't think we've really hung out at any race shops in town.
What about John Wilman's down that way?
Yeah.
Buck Walters down that way with shocks and so forth.
Yeah, he's in Stowe. I don't think I've ever formally met either of those gentlemen. So.
Oh, okay.
Because in the 70s, I went down and did a photo shoot at the Kennedy Racing Garage.
Oh.
And that was a long time ago.
Mm-hmm.
But they were one of the mainstays out at the Reading Fairgrounds. After time in a speedway, Kenny, for qualifying, do you make changes immediately or watch upcoming events to try to get a better read on how the track might be for you in the A main?
So as soon as we come off the heat, depending on how the car handled, we'll usually just take the tires off. But if we qualified, we'll put the feature shocks on and just kind of hang out for a little bit, see if there's going to be consolation races and see how the track's kind of transforming and. It all depends, you know. It depends on the night, but usually we'll kind of not wait till the last second, but we'll try to wait until right when the modifieds are about ready to come out or after the consolations.
What about if you run the consi and starting in the back? Do you like that part, or would you rather start up handicapping in the front, maybe?
In the consi, I'd definitely rather start in the front.
No, I'm saying you qualify in the consi. Now you're going to start the feature. Would you let? Does it matter if you start, like, say, 20th or something? Or would you rather start in the top 6, 8, 10 cars in the future?
I mean, everyone wants to start in the front, but I think it's you get a little more satisfaction if you come from 15th and end up 7th rather than start 3rd and end up 7th.
Yeah. Right, yeah.
So, yeah.
You're progressing instead of regressing.
Exactly, right.
Okay, we got a home viewer. Thank you for calling. How can we direct your question?
Hello, I have a question for Kenny.
Okay.
I was wondering what it was like joining the racing community as a driver and how he's been able to build a network of other drivers.
Well, it was definitely a pleasure joining the racing community. The first year was a little rocky, trying to gain friends with no racing experience whatsoever, but thanks to good guys like Jack Butler and Derek Smith and a lot of the younger guys kind of came together, and there's like a core group of guys here that we have at Grandview that I can say are real good friends of mine, so it's real nice. And anybody that, like, we had a flat tire and a sprint car guy came over and started jacking up the car one night. So
wow.
As a racing family, it's really nice to be a part of something like this. I don't know if I can gain that from a baseball team or a wrestling team, but to have so many people behind you, it's nice.
Okay. Thank you for your call. And with that answer, I have another question here. When you started your race team, how'd you go about getting sponsors, and who are your sponsors on the race car?
So I think that was the trickiest part.
Really?
Because we didn't really have, we just kind of were like, oh, let's buy a car. And it was just spur of the moment.
Well, how do you sell yourself without any experience?
Exactly.
Compared to somebody that has maybe 10 years or something.
Exactly. So I was very gracious. One of my good friends, Nate Halter, owns Halter Landscaping and now owns Slugfest. And he was our first sponsor, just knowing me from playing baseball and growing up with him. So he was our first real big supporter as a company. And then second was probably my godfather. He's his right-hand man ever since I was little. And anything, like, we crash on a Saturday in the middle of June, and he's there, what do you need? And we'll get the car back on the track. So, and then my other another one of my sponsors that first year was Douglas Oil Mechanical. And that Dave Geist, he gave me a job, gave me an opportunity, and gave me a sponsorship. So that guy is a good guy to thank, too, so. But those were our first three, and that's really all we had besides out-of-pocket for us. And I know it was a pretty low-budget year. We got a cheap motor, and not a cheap motor. It was a good motor, but it was monetarily cheap. Same with all of our equipment. We bought used tires, used everything for the first year and some change until we got our feet under us.
Did you go to modified teams and say, you know, can I buy or use tires, or how did you go about
the... A guy that works with my mom works on Frank Cozy's car, Tom Umbenhauer's car. So we got hooked up with Tom, we actually get hooked up with Frank's old tires, and so they're pretty fairly meaty tires, and they're pretty cheap. So
okay, we got one more question, and we're going to go into some pictures. I'll make this a pretty quick one. How far in a race can you realize that your top finishing prospects look good?
I'd probably say halfway through the race, you got a good feel of what your car's doing and whether it's handling properly or if whatever the case is. So I'd say about halfway, and at that point, the complacency starts leaving, and you've got to start start pushing the pressing the limit. So hopefully.
So you'll get a good read then, either the top or the bottom's going to be, and, you know, if there's a guy on the top side and you have it hooked up in the bottom, you know, maybe in one or two laps you're going to get him.
Exactly, yeah. So, yep, you get the feel for how your runs go in, enter in the corner, and see where it sticks and where it doesn't, and I think halfway through, if you don't know that, I don't know if you should be.
Okay, I'll quick add this then. Say you're coming off of turn two, Kenny. How far down to that backstretch are you watching? Are you watching into the third turn, or are you just trying to glance what's around you?
That's tough because I know a lot of the guys like to drive looking at their front bumper. I don't want to say guess, but have a feel for what the guy in front of me is going to do.
Right.
So if we're neck and neck and we're fighting for position and he dives low, I'm just I just pick the opposite. Usually I try not to follow, trying to pass them, right?
So as you are getting more experience, you are starting to get a generalization of what, you know, say Brad Arnold will do, or, you know, one of the other drivers, you'll know what they going into the turn?
Yeah, you know the guys that are catfish diggers on the bottom, and they'll run you on the bottom, and, you know, they'll just get you on the bottom. You definitely get a feel for each driver's driving styles, and if they throw it into the corner a little more or drive it in, you kind of get a feel for that, especially after a couple laps in and following them one or two laps and trying to bide your time to find a good
hole. Is there anybody you go out and follow around, like during hot laps, try to catch up with him and stay with him and run the groove he's running?
I try to get out for hot laps in the later sessions because we have such a dry track, so I try not to get out there in the slop to try to simulate. So usually I'll try to pick whatever my opinion is of the fastest guy.
Whoever happens to be out with you.
Yeah. I try to find a quick guy, but that's I try to, yeah, good competition only makes you better, mm-hmm. So I try to find a fast one.
Okay, we got some interesting pictures we're going to look at, and I think Greg's going to enjoy this more than anybody out of the bunch. So let's go to some pictures here. In fact, I guess we're starting with you right off the bat there, Greg.
Yeah, which car are you there? Which one?
I'm in the far car.
Okay.
And where was that at?
That was at Beaver Springs.
Beaver Springs. Is that what the name of the track was? Or?
Yeah. Up in Pennsylvania, Central PA.
Okay.
Beaver Bob.
Are they still are they still around, or are they?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Is that like New Media or something's up there, isn't it? Or
yeah, it's past there.
Past there?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I knew where that place was at. So yeah. Now, was that your fast timer car, or was that one that you were working on at the time to get it to go faster?
That was as fast as it got, I think. I'll tell you what, the last time out with the car, I went all by myself. I couldn't find anybody to go along because it was late in fall. Not there, but
right.
I went down to Atco. It was the fastest ET and the fastest mile an hour it ever went.
Really?
I went there all by myself.
Now, did you put drag slicks on, or did you have to run a treaded tire?
No, it was all tubbed out and did it all myself.
Wow.
Everything but the automatic transmission.
And what size engine was in it?
402, okay. Big block Chevy.
Could you run injectors, or was it strictly carburetor?
It was carburetor.
Carburetor?
Yeah.
Two fours?
Just one.
Just one four?
Yeah. I did have a Corvette with two fours on it, though.
Next picture, please. And what do we have here?
That's a feature win at Linda's.
Okay.
In the dune
that
buggy.
Was your dune buggy
dune
days.
Dune buggy days.
Yeah.
Now, so how many did you win at Linda's?
Two.
Okay. Two that season? Or?
Yep. Okay. I only ran one full season.
Oh, okay. That. Okay.
I finished second in points.
Good, good.
Yeah. It came down to the last race, too. Terrible.
Now, is that one of them classes where you like the trophy and the accolades more than the money, or did... dune buggies actually have a nice little payout for you.
I can't even remember how much it was. I really can't.
Hot dog and a soda? Bucks,
probably.
Well, now you bought a car for Grandview. Why didn't you buy one for Maple Grove or something and get him into drag racing instead?
They both wanted to dirt tracking.
Oh, okay.
My ex-brother-in-law had a rail for sale, and I was thinking about buying that.
Okay.
But they didn't want to buy that.
No.
They wanted to go dirt racing.
They wanted to go in circles instead.
I don't care.
Yeah.
As long as it's racing, it doesn't matter.
Next picture, please.
Ah. Here's the dune buggy.
And that's the dune buggy.
Yep. That was when I was off-roading at that time.
Do you still have any of these cars, your older cars? You still have any around?
Nope.
Wishful thinking.
Oh.
Was there a reason for the number, or was it one that they gave you?
That number?
72.
I have no idea.
No?
I don't remember why.
Why do you have the number 6 number? For your sportsman?
That was just, I grew up with the number 3, and then I was on a baseball team, and they just doubled my number because someone already had my number.
Okay.
And that just stuck all
so 6 has been your number since?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
And that picture actually is the reason why we have green on our car, as much as it kills.
So I take it you're not superstitious with the green.
I know it's killing my pop-up. But.
Well, that always amazed me, the superstition of green being unlucky, because That's what you're getting paid in. You're getting paid in green. Yeah. So the same way they have, I guess, superstition for, was it $50 bills and half dollars and peanuts and all that. Do you put your driving suit on a certain way? Some guys, they have to put their left foot in.
I just have to wear socks underneath my Nomex socks. I have to wear two pairs of socks.
How is that in the beginning, though? First, you got to buy a helmet, a driving suit, the underwear, the shoes. You invest, what, $1,000, $2,000 before you even get in the car?
And that was before I even knew if I liked it.
Well, that's what I mean. Before you even get in the car and start it up, you're already investing that much money.
Yeah.
So it was $1,000.
Oh, at least, yeah.
Yeah, we were just.
And then if you use the Hans or whatever, you got to get that too.
Yeah. We were just hoping that I liked it, and we were going to use it until the Snell things ran out.
Do you have the full containment seat?
Yes.
Okay. Yep. Okay, let's go to the next picture, which I think we might be getting to you soon. There we go.
Ah, there we are.
That's the first year.
Okay. Who'd you get the car from?
Tom's son, Jordan Umenhauer, so Jared's brother.
Okay.
And that was the number 19 modified that ran. I actually got to watch that car run the 76er before we bought it. It was pretty neat.
Now, did they give you advice on setups and things like that, or was this one of these things you had to learn on your own?
He was more than helpful with everything. Any questions, any little thing.
It Tom was just, came down to the house a couple of times.
Jordan actually was a pretty good little driver. Though. Yeah, he wasn't bad. You know.
Yeah.
He just ran out of money, basically.
Right, yeah.
Okay, now once you hop into that car, what part of the front, can you see the shock towers? Can you see the, because you say you look down the track, but what actually, when you sit in that car, can you see in the front end?
I can see a lot more than people think. I know, like, for instance, Jeff Strunk likes it. Like, he always looks so little in his cars. He sits real low. Yeah. He gets his stuff made low. I sit very high, so I can see a lot of what, like, I see the top of the hood. I see the part of the nose piece, and I see the wheels and the shock, so I can see pretty much.
Can you see through the cars in front of you and see, like, two or three cars down?
It depends. If it's lined up right, I can see through their screens because there's nothing there but fencing, so.
Yeah.
Okay. Who does your graphics?
Joe Adams.
Okay.
Oh. Do you just say, here's the car?
Every time.
Do you just give him the car and say, do what you want? Or
We have him design it online, and Mama Bear over there, she is the ultimate decider of what goes and what stays.
Does he do a rap, or does he just...
This year he did it. He did a rap, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So is...
And he actually painted one of his drag cars, so we've known
him. He worked for Bob Hilbert in the alley in Boyertown.
No, I know you had the car down at the Coventry Mall, and everybody liked the way it looked this year. It really looked impressive down there.
Okay, so who's in charge of the colors? Is your mom in charge of, hey, we're going to make this green and this blue and this, or how's this?
I think it's a little bit, I think we all decided the first year, and year by year, I think we just tell Joe to change it up a little bit, and... he'll send us over, and we'll just trial and error type deal, I think.
Okay. And what are we looking at here?
That's the car from the mall show.
Okay.
Is that still your original first car now?
No. Or? Well, same chassis and everything. Different motor, but pretty much all the same.
I know you said you crashed at Susquehanna.
Yeah, so...
And you bent the frame, broke the frame, I guess.
Yeah, we broke the frame. That was the first year. We got it fixed. We actually raced that next week at Grandview. Who the heck fixed that time?
Neil Huber.
And then now we get all our body work done, or all of our chassis work done by Bob Strunk.
Okay. Who does your engines?
Nick Gatto.
Okay. And shocks?
Integra. We don't really have an Integra.
Jason.
BFP.
Oh, so do you do a lot of your own fabrication and stuff like that? Your own...
Your side rails and stuff like that?
We got them all from Bobby Strong. And the body, Jared Umenhauer made the body at BFP.
Okay. Home viewer line, 610-378-0426. The Lowdown and Dirty meet and greets are held every week outside the main gate. Have you done any of them? And do you enjoy being fan-friendly prior to putting on your race face?
I think that's one of my favorite parts about racing, honestly, is getting to meet all the people and just sharing experiences and talking and, you know, especially when the kids come by. It's always nice to have some candy. And
you let them sit in the car?
Oh, for sure. That's why I don't know when I was little I ever got to sit in a modified or anything growing up. So I think if I would have, I think instead of playing sports, we'd be racing race cars.
Oh, you would have done that?
I think so.
Maybe 10 years earlier.
Yeah.
Almost did.
So does the idea of seeing new faces coming up in the pits every week after the race over give you an impression that you're actually improving and doing things the right way?
Yeah, it does. Especially, I heard a lot at the Coventry Mall. Some lady was, I think she jokingly said this, but she said, "I don't hear a lot of boos when they say your name." Yeah, you know, it's kind of good. See if you hear more chin, something.
Well,
I don't
now,
know.
You're racing the Sportsman for what, like 3 years?
Yep.
Do you ever wish you would have started with go-karts and slingshots and quarter midgets and all that kind of stuff? Or?
For sure. I wish I would have gotten into racing a little bit younger. It was tough growing up playing baseball, and like I wrestled from the time I was in kindergarten to 12th grade, and played baseball for a year longer than that, and after that, and still playing baseball. So that's tough, but I would have definitely liked to dabble in it at least when I was little, just to see, and maybe I would have picked it up, and we'd have been here.
Okay, we got a home viewer. Thank you for calling. How can we direct your question?
This is to Kenny. Kenny, do you think it's fair for some of these modified guys to come down and race the 38er against you guys?
Man.
You don't have to, Kenny, you don't have to answer that, and I'm sure you know who this is.
Oh, now I do, now that you said that. But I get, that's a tough one because, you know, it's an open race, so mm-hmm. I mean, there's no rule against it, so I can't really complain any, but I know, if I make it up there and be a successful dirt driver, I don't think you'd catch me doing that.
Okay. I'll boo you for the heck of it.
I know you will, Jesse. You
used to have like Brett Hearn or, you know, different guys that would come to Syracuse and run the 358 race.
Mm-hmm.
And they'd win against the regular 358 guys. So that happens no matter where you're going.
Right, exactly. You know? It is what it is. I'll race them just as hard, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because a lot of guys, what they'll say is if somebody moves down, it makes their game that much better. They got to do better to, you know, so.
I mean, a race car driver, like, it doesn't matter who's behind the seat. You're still racing. You're still
out there racing somebody.
Exactly,
it's just so the car you got.
It's just like when the 410 guys go down to URC or whatever and run. Yeah. You know, same thing.
So. Yeah.
We're having the Kyle Busch syndrome.
Yeah.
Do you have any hobbies other than racing, or is it so time-consuming that racing is all you can fit into your free time schedule?
Well, I do. I play baseball on Sundays. I actually just joined another baseball team. So
hardball?
I'll be playing with Derek Smith, the 20 sportsman. I'll be playing with his team on Wednesdays and Sundays. So I'll be doing double duty for that. But yeah, between work and racing, and I got a dog at home and a girlfriend, and my schedule's pretty packed.
Yeah, Derek Side Smith jobs. is a interesting guy. He's quiet.
Yeah,
he kind of he doesn't bother people. He just kind of does his thing
until you get to know.
But he's developing into a really good, decent racer.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I know he raced quarter midgets for like for some minute period of time, he wishes he stayed with it, but like he played sports just like I did, mm-hmm. So he played baseball. And
he had his dad there with him growing up.
Yeah,
his
exactly.
dad was a champion down at East Windsor with the street stocks and so forth. And then he had Todd Smith also and Chris Esposito. So he had a lot of help getting him to where he's going. But he's really developing into a pretty decent racer.
Yeah, you know? I think he got some new equipment this year, got a new frame. And
yeah, he said he got a 604 now instead of the 602. Yeah. So he's coming to get you.
Yeah, I'm excited for it.
Well, I got to ask a strange question, Kenny. Tom Miller used to run the Sportsman's down at Grandview, number 77. He's the manager of one of the Burke senior softball teams. Now, we played together back in the 80s when he asked me to return. Well, I'm 63 years old, though, had knee replacement, and he said, you don't have to be there every game. They don't even run to the bases. They just walk to the bases. And I'm going, hey, this might be pretty cool. I might have to try this. And he says, their all-star second baseman is Ray Swinehart.
So really?
I didn't realize that.
That's awesome.
So I said, well, maybe I'll have to come to a couple of these games, but this slow-pitch softball is a little bit different than hardball, but it's still a way to get out get some exercise. Do you have a regular group of pit and garage helpers?
Yes, I have a very regular crew, and by regular I mean like two or three guys. It's Mike Garrett, who worked with him at the dairy at Clover Farms Dairy for a while. and his two sons, Mike Jr. and Dustin. And between Mike and Dustin, those guys just kill it. I can't complain.
If it wasn't for them, I'd be pulling my hair out at the races.
We honestly, it would be tough for us to race. We also have my godfather, one of the sponsors. He helps on the car quite often, comes to all the races.
Those guys go to New York with us and everything, and they drive their own vehicle, everything. You know.
What's your at track duties then, Greg, for the car?
Well, get it unloaded and.
Do you do the fuel and the tires and
It's kind
I
of.
I don't do a whole lot of tires. Mike and Dusty do that. I'll do the fuel. And then when we change the setup, I'll help with that.
From his mom's notes.
Yeah.
Changing. What do you do during the week? Cool. Then? Do you have in the garage? Do you have duties?
I do most all of it at the house, unless I need help.
Oh, while he's working, you're out.
Yeah, he's retired, right? So that's his job.
I have all day. But unless I need help with something during the day, Mike will come down because he works nights. He'll come. He came down yesterday and helped me out. And just works out pretty good.
Can you run a whole season on an engine, Kenny, or must you get it refreshed every so many races?
Well, the first year we ran the entire season, fairly successful one for our first year anyway. We ran the whole season on a used motor, didn't get fresh. We didn't even know it was in it. We just had New Egypt seals on it. We were just like, let's hope this works. So I think if you take the preventative maintenance and just like your car, you know, I mean, stuff does happen where, you know, you bend a rod or blow something up or something happens. But I think for the most part, we do enough of maintenance in the week that we should be able to last a whole season.
Okay, how close to the minimum weight do you come on the scale?
I think we're over by like 50. We're over by a good bit.
Is that with the full fuel cell or?
No, we.
Do you run a completely full fuel cell during the course of the night?
Never.
Just what you need to get through that event?
You drive through the mud afterwards to get more weight?
At the most, I think we run 10 gallons was the most we've had in it.
Yeah.
For a feature, I think that was the 38er.
We usually scale it with like four gallons in it.
We're down to 10 minutes. Home viewer line 610-378-0426. Some teams have qualifying tires and then feature tires. Do you have this or do you run the same tire throughout the whole night?
Like I said, it depends on the track again. We really have a tire rack in the trailer that we will get a good idea of what we think we're gonna run, but if I don't like how the track is or if it's real dry, we'll get it on the fly deals. And if we are going to run a tire from the heat race, we'll prep it there and make sure it's all good to go for the feature.
Are you a bottom feeder or a top, or do you run wherever you have to go?
I run wherever I have to go, but personally, I know you guys don't like to hear this, but I love running the top. I love having like getting the motor wound up and keeping the momentum up on the top side. And I know one race this year, me and Ryan Belts, I was on the outside, he was on the inside, and I think we were like door to door for like 15 laps, man.
It was a long time. That was the most fun.
I never touched. Yeah, I think that was.
They were side by side.
How often do you lift on a lap? Do you go all the way around full bore, or do you lift going into the turn?
It depends. The feature, the slick track's pretty tough to just go around not lifting, but hot laps, I try not to lift. Heat race depends it depends where you're at.
Mm-hmm.
Is the driver in car a big help for you, or do you have trouble hearing it?
This year, I'm hoping it's going to be great because I have these new racer ear protection things that have the molds, and they go in real deep, and they should be able to block out the sound and allow me to hear a little clearer. But for the most, I used iPhone headphones for 2 years or 3 years, and they seem to work just fine. Okay. It's just a matter of the other noise, I think. It's not the radio, it's just the other.
You think that's a great improvement to racing when they yell in their, yellow, yellow, or watch the outside or whatever?
Yeah, I mean, it has saved me, like, personally, behind the wheel, it saved me quite a few times, but I know it has hurt me a couple of times as well, so.
Okay, you're sort of in the front of the pack as the night's going on. Do you find issues with lap cars? Is there a way of, you know, keeping them from squirreling all over the place? I mean, they see the flag and they think they can go faster now to stay ahead of the leaders. Do you find there's, like, they need some kind of a mid-zone or something to come up with for lap traffic?
I know growing, like, watching racing, that's my favorite part of the race, is the lap traffic when the leader has to start passing cars again. So that's my favorite part. As a previous lap car and maybe future lap car sometime, you know, that's what racing is about. You know, if you're getting lapped, it's almost a religious experience. It's daunting having those leaders. You hear Kenny Bock, you're the leaders, and you're like, it's almost good practice for you to just practice rolling the bottom and staying out of their way, because it's their responsibility to pass you. So, and that was the biggest thing I had to learn when I was a rookie, was just let them pass you. Just,
well, sometimes they say, like, the back 10 or so, 12 cars, whatever, get all the same money. Do you keep running around even though, say, you're 18th or 15th and you're not going anywhere? You keep stay out there, or do you just pull off and save the car for next week?
I do, because it's only my third year, I still need as much seat time as I possibly can.
Okay.
But I mean, I feel like in maybe 5 or 6 years or a little more, it would kind of be a waste. But I mean, who's out here for the money, you know? So
right. No one's, yeah.
Okay. So you didn't give us a whole list of your sponsors, and Kenny, what do we got on the car for the 2019 season?
All right, the 2019 season, we have Halter Landscaping, Douglas Hill Mechanical, ACEC Hogs, Slugfest, Barnes Equipment, and one of our newest sponsors is TK Contracting, which is one of my good friends from high school. Travis Kohler is a sponsor this year, so thanks to him. And another new one is Helen's Bakery. So if anyone has a cookie order to put in, my girlfriend does custom cookies. So
now, are the sponsors on both sides of the car?
Yeah, we have. So I know a lot of guys have mismatching sides. We have same sides. Both sides are the same. So whatever side you can see me from the track.
Well, me and Randy do the RCN TV broadcast down there, so okay. We'll make sure that, you know.
Yep. So if you ever get like Gunther Walsh, where you have 25
Oh, man. Right?
And you have to have different sides, you're going to have to change it. So.
Okay, we're down to 5 minutes, a couple more questions. If anything could be changed at Grandview, what would you suggest?
Dryer pits.
I know. Well, Brad comes in and soaks them.
We're down in the hole, so sometimes we'll just spread hay, you know, so we don't get muddy. I'm partial to Grandview because I grew up there, and I love that place. There's not much to, in my opinion, that can change. I know it's a bummer that we lost the late models, but I still think they're going to be able to put on a pretty good show despite losing a class, but gaining some classes that normally we wouldn't see there. So.
Well, how does Grandview compare? Like, you went to Five Mile Point, you went to Susquehanna, did you go to Big Diamond or any of New Egypt or anything like that?
Yeah, we haven't been to New Egypt or Bridgeport yet, but out of all the tracks, I think Grandview does the best track prep. It's second to none. We went up to all the New York tracks that we've been to. They were out there running the track in right before hot laps, and then you didn't see another piece of equipment on the track the entire night.
Okay.
So.
Okay. Now, what about sanctioning? You really think Grandview has to be a NASCAR sanctioned track? For the driver's insurance is fantastic.
Right.
But other than that, is there more perks to it than people don't realize, or how's that work?
You know, that's tough. I don't really know. I haven't been around long enough to give you a good answer, but I know it is a kind of pain in the neck when you want your friends to come and they don't want to sit by themselves in the stands, so it's tough to get them in the pits. But
okay, would you like to see a few more bigger money races added to the schedule during the course of the year?
Yeah, yes, I would love. You know, who doesn't want to race for more money? I just hope if they do that, they put us first feature or second feature, not dead last.
Well, they have like the Summer Splash, which is a big race.
Yeah.
And you're now going to be the Firecracker 40.
Yes.
So they have that. So you plus the 38er, plus the opening night show, Bruce Rogers.
Yeah, it's definitely, I mean, the Bruce Rogers show, that's an addition to from last year. That's just another a bigger race that we get to see more competition in.
Okay, so before my announcement here, your race team or personal social media outlets?
I don't have any yet.
It's anything just on Bock Facebook? Racing.
Yeah, I mean, I'm on Facebook. I have an Instagram, but working on that.
Is merchandise going to be available?
Yes.
I will have to.
Hey, we'll match at the track this year. So our t-shirts, we're going to be buying. We're hoping to get a good action shot from this upcoming week for practice to put on the shirt with the new sponsors and
pictures.
Stuff. All right.
I'll be there taking pictures.
We'll see you.
Okay. So that was the Kenny Bock team for the 2019 season. You can see him down at Grandview Speedway on Saturday. Come on down to the free practice on Saturday from noon to 5. Big news in the last few weeks. Action Track USA co-owner and promoter Doug Rose has purchased Bridgeport Speedway in New Jersey with his intentions of watching closely behind the scenes in 2019 before a full track takeover in 2020. Classes and schedule will be announced prior to the start of the 2020 season. And that's a track you'd actually like to get to, Kenny?
I think so.
Scares me.
Yeah, I enjoy new tracks, but
well, they have three different tracks there.
That's the big track is still daunting to me. You know,
the 3/8 is kind of like Grandview.
That's the same size as Grandview.
Yeah.
So we might be able to see it down there.
I mean, even Susquehanna going down those straightaways, you're just, when's this going to end?
I remember Mike Wells one time at Penn National. He used to run Grandview all the time, and he went out to Penn National. And I said, how's it like running the bigger track compared to the smaller track? He says, hell, you can brush your teeth going down the back stretch.
Yeah, you're right.
Okay, this was a fantastic show. So Strapped In is going to be on YouTube. So if you want to see any of the Strapped In shows, go to YouTube.com, hit in BCTV Strapped In. Kenny's show will be coming on in the not-too-distant future. And a lot of our past shows are on there if you want to watch that. So on behalf of Randy Kane, Greg Bock, Kenny Bock, I'm Mike Feltenberger. Thank you and have a good evening.